Amen.
Man.
Amen. No better place to be than in the hands of a just God. We are at a place in this text that I thought fit the struggle and the work here at Uptown Church of Christ. My job is to preach to the needs of the church, and help the church see itself in the scriptures. We are in a place and time in which I believe that God is calling people out, and there has to be at least a cognitive awareness of where you are in the scriptures. So I invite you to turn to the book of Luke, chapter 14, if you will, and visit with me the great physician's message, beginning at verse number 16 in the words of Christ. I remember one day going to a store that I frequently visited and found that they had a sign up. The sign said, "Going out of business. Everything must go." Now, I remember walking through that store and wondering, how could such a chain, such a business like Vaughn's Grocery Store, in such a dynamic location, be going out of business? And I remember walking through the store, and I remember hearing employees argue back and forth with one another. And I finally decided to ask the manager, what happened to Vaughn's here in Chula Vista? How did you go out of business? And I later learned at another location they went out of business. And he was baffled. He looked and he said, "You know, really, I can't get into all the details of what's happened. I can tell you that we had some internal problems that could not be overcome." And as I was talking, I was thinking, well, did you advertise enough? Did you talk to enough people about the store when it was needed? Did you put yourself out there? Did you launch yourself again when it was needed most? And I remember the expression on his face almost to look like there was nothing that could have been done to stop this travesty. When we look at this great text, we find Jesus Christ, the great cook who begs many to come. He invites his people, those that were Jews, to this great dinner. It was a special invitation, and he invited them to come to eat a dinner cooked by Christ. Now I want you to get this, every man, because if Emeril Augustus would have invited folk to dinner, people would have come. Certainly, if Jesus invited you to receive some spiritual food on Sunday morning, folk ought to be excited to get their food.
Man.
He is a better cook than Emeril. He's a better cook than any chef, any five-star restaurant that there is. And what was surprising about the text, and what was surprising to the manager, is that with such a great invitation, you know, when stores go out of business, they lower their prices to 50 and 75%, but people still weren't coming. When Jesus offered himself, when Jesus bade them to come, look at the text. The Bible says that the first said unto him, "I bought a piece of land or ground and must need to go see it." When Jesus invited them, they began to say, "Well, I have five yokes of oxen and I can't go prove them." When Jesus invited them, one said, "I have just gotten married and I'm on my honeymoon. I can't come." And I wonder this morning, when Christ invites you into a relationship with him, what's your excuse this morning? God is looking at the people of Israel, the children of Jerusalem. He's looking at them. He's invited them, essentially, when we get into the spiritual paradigm of this lesson, into a relationship with him in which he's going to feed them manna from heaven. And their response is, "I'm not interested in your cooking."
Well,
that seems like the position that the church has today. Just look around. Folk come to church when they want to now. When the invitation is sent out in Hebrews 10:25. "Forsake not the assembling of ourselves together." Matthew chapter 11, verse number 28. "Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden and heavy burdened. Yes. I'll give you rest." He gives a great invitation every day for your trials and your struggles and things that you for a word from the man of God, and I'm going to bless you through my word. I'm going to feed you the bread of life.
Yes, sir.
Folk are laying down saying, well, I'm mad at somebody and I can't come. And when I looked at the manager, he said he had an internal problem. I wondered, had the employees argued enough about what they thought the manager should have been doing until they ran all the customers off? You know, there's nothing worse than going to a place that's so divided that when you go in to do business with them, it's like you're walking into the middle of a fist fight. That had enough of bad attitudes and poor customer service, shut funds down, had enough of mismanagement, had enough of this or that. Everything but what Jesus had put on the aisles had it finally succumbed, reached the point to where the store had to put up a sign, going out of business. Everything must go. Jesus recognizes the dire condition of his invitation. He realizes that his invitation has been rejected.
Man.
Jesus then said, well, I'll tell you what I want you to do. Everybody got to get out of here. And I want you to go into the highways and to the byways. And I want you to go out to the streets. And I want you to find the lame. I want you to find the hurt. I want you to find the brokenhearted. I want you to find folk that need me and tell them I'm serving dinner. And I'm serving dinner at the Church of Christ.
Man,
y'all ought to be shouting right. Yes, now. Say amen. But now once again, the invitation to the word, it only falls upon ears that want to hear the word of God. See, folk that want to praise God right now are in a feasting position,
yes,
in which they are dining on the word of God and can't help but say, thank you for the meal because it was showing up good. And is there anybody hungry for the word of God this morning?
Man.
If you're hungry for the word of God, you don't want to be the people who turn down Jesus at his invitation. What a scary thought that Jesus invites you into a relationship with him and you tell him, no, not now, maybe tomorrow. He then begins to look at, and we begin to look at socially right now in 2015, over 31 churches closed in Arkansas, over 25 churches shut down, Churches of Christ shut down in Texas. Over 50 churches have closed in the northeastern area. When we look at the pattern, that there seem to be as many churches closing as there are opening, it appears that the same invitation that they turned down from Jesus, they're now turning down from the man of God to meet Jesus at the buffet table.
Man,
that's a scary thought right now. And what I want to know is that when you turn him down, where are you going to go? When you turn your back on God, where are you going to go? It's a scary thing. It's a scary thing to turn down an invitation from God. But let me tell you something. God's house will stand forever. You won't praise God, somebody gonna praise God. You don't want your meal, somebody eat your food.
Yes, sir.
You don't want what God got for you, somebody will take your blessing. You don't want to say thank you, Jesus, somebody will be grateful to Jesus.
Uh-huh.
You don't want to give him glory, somebody will give him glory. You too proud to know that you're missing a good thing. God got somebody out there who will say, yes, Lord, your will and your way.
Reach.
Look at this text. You'll find that the first evaluation of Jesus' invitation and his rejection from the Jews, it should be asked, is the product good enough? Let me say that again. Is the product good enough? Because folk don't turn down stuff that's good. And so I'm wondering, is the product good enough for you this morning? When you lay down last night, a heartbeat away from death, did he wake you up this morning?
Yes.
Did his blood cleanse you from your sins? Was he graceful and merciful through the week for you? Did it protect you on your comings and your going? Is the product good enough? Is the Church of Christ good enough for you anymore?
Man.
We look at this text, we'll find that if you come into this store, come into this banquet table, Jesus has some of the finest meals you could ever eat. Who doesn't need love? There's a survey saying that there almost 90% of the people are craving to be loved by either a significant other or a husband or a wife, because it is in the natural instinct of a baby to come out wanting to be loved and held by somebody that loves them, in particular their mother or their father. Love is a necessary ingredient of the recipe that God serves. And has God not loved us enough? Is his love not good enough for you that you can't turn from sin and love God in spirit and truth? Don't you know you've been loved? You've been loved so much God died for you. Is his love not so good to you that you stop coming to church and come to worship God in spirit and truth?
Yes.
Don't you feel love that God put up with your stuff but loved you so much he woke you 5. But God, who is rich in mercy, for with his great love, wherewith he loved us. What great love do you speak of, preacher? I'm talking about a love that know that you're going to reject him and still die on Calvary's cross in spite of you. I'm talking about a love that know that you'll spit on him, but yet he still prays for you. I'm talking about a love that know that you don't even care about what go on in his house, but he still provides for you. I'm talking about a love that gives you a job and know you're not going to give. I'm talking about a love that loves you even though we don't love him. You ought to want some of that love.
Man.
God said he had a great love. How great was the love? Well, Ephesians chapter 5, round the verse 8, for God, he demonstrated his love that while we were yet in sin, while we were rejecting him, while we were downing him, while we were calling him a devil, while we were planning on crucifying him, that he died on Calvary's cross for your sins and my sins. While we were saying, not today, God said, I got to die while it's that time coming. No man can work when nighttime comes. I got to go up the youngest cross and get on the cross and die for those people's sins. Because somebody in the house, somebody's going to love me. Somebody's going to need me, and somebody's going to appreciate
Man.
Me. What a great love yes. to love somebody that don't love you. What a great love to love somebody
yes.
that needs you.
Freak.
What a great love to love somebody that ain't thinking about you, but what they can get from you. But they love you. He loves you anyway. What a great love Amen. That he has for us. And yet we turn down his invitation. It takes long to say that we were dead in sins, but he quickened us together. Where? Together with Christ. For by grace you are saved. But don't start getting excited about grace, because grace by itself never saved anybody. But grace with faith and love is a doable combination that can save everybody. There's a great invitation on the table and on the serving plate, on the menu. Love is on the menu. Grace is on the menu. And you get your extra entrees of faith and love. 1 Timothy 1. Verse number 14, and the grace of our Lord, the Bible says, was abundant with faith and love which was in Christ Jesus. What do you mean, preacher? That you can have grace outside of Jesus. Grace is only in Christ. Grace is only in Christ. What puts you in Christ? Faith puts you through baptism, puts you where? In Christ. And when I have faith and I have love, I get baptized. Christ in Christ, and dynamic trio work together, but you have to want to eat what God has. How many of you want some grace in your life tomorrow?
Man.
How many of you need some grace in your diet?
Yes.
How many need some grace? How many of you got yourself together? You don't need no grace. If you need grace right now, you need the grace of God. Can't you stand up and say, Lord, give me my grace? Yeah. Well, there's just a few people need some grace. I mean, I gotta preach hard this morning. You need for the Lord, and I'm gonna get to go home. These folks say they don't need no grace. Let me tell you something. Without grace, we'd all be in a world of trouble.
Man.
Without grace, we'd all be doomed and lost. But grace is only accompanied by faith and love. And when God invites you to a relationship with him, he invites you to a relationship with him that says, despite what you're doing, what you've done, my grace is sufficient.
Man.
Because I intend to take you to another level in our relationship that you and I can sit down and sup together. As I knock on your door, if any man shall open the door, I will sup with him, he will sup with me. How many of you would have turned down the great supper invitation that Christ gave the Jews in the text? Let's look at the text very quickly. The text says that he invited his friends, he invited the Jews, he invited his people to come and sup with him, and they turned him down. You have turned down Jesus this morning. Bigger question, how many of you will turn down Jesus this morning?
Good question.
And what has the consequence been? Not doing it God's way has caused spiritual sugar diabetes. Your feet that should have been shined with the preparation of the gospel have now been cut off by the devil. He's cut you down to the nubs and you can't hardly get around. Your hands that would have been productive, strong, being well fed and nourished, now are buffered with spiritual arthritis, and you are unable to hold on to even the very blessings that God has given you. Your eyes have been covered with the illness of sugar diabetes, that you're blind and you cannot see afar off. How many of you have been eating something that the devil cooked Lord says, come to my banquet table and I'll feed you. And you'll be healthy because I have 100% protein. No sugar. Well, there's a little sugar, but no fat. Y'all ought to say amen. Yeah. It's a highly protein diet. It's good for you too. There's nutrition and vitamin B, but most of all, vitamin C. Seed for the cross. Seed for Christ. Seed for comforting spirit.
Man.
Seed for being able to see your way out of dark spots. Am I right about it? You got all the vitamins that you need. And somebody, I say, thank you, Jesus, for the invitation.
Amen.
Perhaps these people, don't you think these are bold people in the text who turned down an invitation for God? How arrogant must you be to receive an invitation from Christ and turn it down every time? How arrogant must one be when God says, when you come into my house, I don't want you coming here with no other reason but the taste of my food. How arrogant must one be to sit up in the house of God and tell him his food is simply not good enough. It's not good enough, and the devil has something else that I want to eat. But not only does he offer love and grace, but Christ only can offer salvation. He invites them to come have a relationship with him through this dining of the meal and of the receiving of his word, that they might be saved. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 14, look at the Bible says, therefore, I do all things for the saints' sake, for the elect's sake, that they may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus. I don't care what you're dealing with, what you're going through. You need to understand one thing. There's nothing nobody has done, nothing nobody else will do, that you can't endure and that you can't go through so that you might be saved. Don't you let nobody who refuses to go to the table cause you to lose your soul. You need to make up your mind right now that if the church is going to stay in business, you're going to do your part to make sure that the church stay in business.
Man.
Oh, y'all act like this is a possibility. You remember over in Revelation chapter 3, the church that received a scarlet, scathing discipline from Christ. He talked to the church of the Laodiceans. Y'all remember the church of Laodicea? Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
Remember that he talked to them. He said, I know thy works, that you're neither hot nor cold. It's not that you go all the way over to the other side, but it's that you yet come all the way over to my side. It's not that you turn the invitation down, but you said you might be there. Have you ever called somebody by coming to the Lord's house and say, I might make it, I might not, I don't know yet? Well, you know what? You're right. You might not make it. But I tell you what, if you don't make it to the house of God and you die in your sins, the Bible says that where I am,
you
cannot come.
Man.
You're right. You might not make it next week. You might not make it to forgive somebody. You might not make it to stand for the bus stand. You might, you just might not make it. But if you don't make it, remember you turned down the invitation of God for you to have salvation to work in your life. God says, I have grace, love, faith. I have mercy and salvation. Stand for dinner. Somebody said it ain't good enough. How many of you can't use any of that this morning? How many of you can't use some grace this morning? How many of you couldn't use some love this morning? How many of you couldn't use some hope this morning? How many couldn't use some peace? What's going on in the soul? Why is Vaughn's closing? Because the population in which he served didn't feel like his stuff was good enough anymore. It's closed because they felt like they had found something better or cheaper than Vaughn's. But let me tell you something. A good healthy relationship with God, relationship, there is no substitute for a relationship with God. Your boyfriend is not on the same level with God. Your wife is not on the same level with God. I don't care what happens in your relationship. Keep your hand in God's hand.
Amen.
They found a substitute. They found some dogs to wash. They found some ox. One of them said, I just bought 7 oxes, and so I'm not going to eat at the Lord's table. Another one said, I just got married, so just get married. I'm not going to the Lord's table. If you just got married, you sure enough ought to be going to the Lord's table right now.
Man.
You just got married. The first thing you need to do after honeymoon morning is find the church house and get in and say, Lord, help us.
Amen.
Look at this great text. We're then left to evaluate the second question. Well, we've determined that the product is good enough. Then what's the problem? Why are they going out of business? Why is there potential not to have anybody show up on Sunday morning at the church? Well, it is a sign that the population in which Vons is dealing with, in which the church is dealing with has become inflexibly intellectual. They have become so smart that they're stupid. I shared a statistic on the radio yesterday, and I showed how there was a study that demonstrated that the United States had ranked number 14 in by way of education. Number 14 by way of education of other countries. But then we rank number 2 in ignorance. What do you mean number 2? Well, spiritually, what I'm suggesting to you that maybe the teaching that we've allowed in every church is the Lord's church, and every attitude is accepted, and every traditional nepotism way is accepted to God, is to charge our ignorance that we don't know God at all. And that the only reason that we've been coming to funds, we've been coming to church, is because they had something that we liked for the moment. But as soon as prices went up, as soon as something went the way we didn't like it, because we were not really connected with the community and the store, we begin to find somewhere else to go. I'm looking at inflexible, meaning that they were unteachable, meaning that it didn't matter how hard you preached. They had already came in with their mind made up that the preacher can't tell me nothing. Some people inflexible mean that you can't tell them nothing, can't teach them nothing, because they already know something. They already know everything. And since they already know everything, they just come into the house of God to sit back and judge and critique whatever goes on, because they're inflexible. And you can preach it, you fall out. They made up their mind that they cannot learn anything, that they are all right by themselves. Perhaps these folk who turned Jesus down, you thought about that for a minute, who turned Jesus down. Do you understand that when I say at the end of the sermon that if you heard the word of God and you believe the word of God, repent of your sins, confess your faults, confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and then put him on in baptism. That is not an invitation from me. That's an invitation from the Lord. And if you're in a situation in which you have learned something and you can learn something, if you stand in the guilty distance of sin, you ought to get up and say, Lord, it's me, standing in the need of prayer.
Man.
We've met some people that will put you out of business because you can't teach them nothing, can't tell them nothing. Going around all week when the invitation was going out, I could see those apostles working diligently. To Jesus is cooking supper, but I can see the Jews watching them. That's your job. I don't mention Jesus on my job. I don't mention Jesus in my neighborhood. Folk don't even know I'm a member of the church. I don't mention Jesus to my friends. I tell them about a concert. I don't mention Jesus here or there. I don't mention Jesus until Sunday morning. And if I feel like getting up, and if I want to get up, I'll come to church. But I don't think about Jesus until Sunday morning. This type of behavior, spirit, can help to put the church out of business. But God's church will last to the end of time.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but if you look at this great text, there's a warning about this type of people. The Bible says that those type of people who, number one, don't find me good enough, that my food is not good enough for, those type of people, number two, who I cannot teach anything, that I cannot serve the word of life, he said they will not ever be bid again to eat at this table again. Y'all go back to the text. Y'all look like I made that up. All right, and another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I what?
And
I cannot come. Next verse, 21. 21. So that the servant came and showed the Lord these things. Then the master of the house, which represented Christ, being angry, said to his servant, you go out there quickly. This is where I'm going now. What do I do when folk won't come to church? What do I do when the people who make up the church won't support the church? Do you give up? Do you let the devil put somebody in your place? Do you walk out and throw your hands up? Brother Hill, you ought to just left. You can go get another church somewhere. You ought to leave it. Just leave them alone. What do you do? You ought to get, they don't respect you. They ain't listening to you. They do what they want to. They act like they want to. They'll kill, they lie on you. They spread gossip. What should you do? Jesus said, let me tell you something. You go out there quickly. You get out in the streets and the lanes of the city. You bring in some folk who need me. Y'all didn't hear that, did you? Sometimes we spend time with the wrong population. Sometimes you talk to folk that's telling you, I don't need God. How you know they don't need it? I don't come on Tuesday because I don't need to study. How you know they don't need it? I don't read my Bible. I don't need Jesus. I don't need him every Sunday. I come if I want. I don't need him. He said, you're wasting your time talking to folk who don't need me. Every time I turn around, I talk to somebody who's already a member of the Church of Christ. I'm spending my time with folk who said, I don't need Jesus. And if I don't have Jesus, I'll come. He serves something that I like. What you mean? Sarah, bring some food up here on Sunday. Bring some ham hocks and some greens and some potato salad, some macaroni and cheese. What y'all like to eat? What y'all like to eat? Broccoli with cheese on it? Just broccoli. Broccoli with cheese on it. What else y'all like to eat? Greens. So they better say greens. Greens that make you mean. What else y'all like to eat? Neck bones. That's a country back over there. Neck bones. Was that mine that said that?
No.
What you know about neck bone? You're from California, she said neck bone. Amen, amen. Y'all know something about neck bones out here?
Yeah.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Lord have mercy. You know, we're the same. We like it. I thought y'all was angels. We like it. Y'all eat neck bones?
Yeah.
Do you eat chillers and mountains?
Yeah, I eat chillers.
You like some chillers? What? What?
I want a corny asada burrito.
Oh, man, the church is home. Church is home. God, we have the worst. We need the same stuff. But it not nothing that when the church serves food, when you serve something folk like, in other words, if you preach a sermon that is void of vices, if you preach a lesson that does not cause sin, that when Joel Osteen was asked flat out, is homosexuality sin? He would not respond that it was sin. If you go to a church where you hear two scriptures, I'm going to tell you something. A lot of the preachers, even in the body of Christ, have tried to preach expository lessons, which require two scriptures, in which they simply pull stuff out of those two scriptures and don't go to any other scriptures. And folks sit in the church for hours at a time and listen